is called avagraha. As though before sandhi it is amritam. There should be no avagraha. Avagraha is that slant English S. In the transliteration, you have second line, bhavati no mritam. A hyphen is there between no, N-O and M-R-I-T-A-M. So you must delete that hyphen in the transliteration. You must delete that slant S, which we call avagraha in the Devanagari. Why? There is no A at all. No amritam. No, otherwise it would mean as though there was amritam. You know, in a sentence like soham, you put avagraha, because when you split the sandhi, it is so aham. There is a silent A. But here there is no silent A. The sandhi split is na plus u plus mritam. There is no amrita here. So this was a typing error or whatever. Alright. 13th says, laya vinashane. This is what we call a dvandva samasa. Layascha vinashanancha. Dissolution or just subsiding and destruction. Ramascha Krishnascha, Rama Krishnau, we say. Rama and Krishna went to the forest, let's say. Rama and Lakshmana went to the forest. So we call it Dvandva Samasa, Rama and Lakshmana, Rama Lakshmanau. Or Sita Ramau, Sita cha Ramascha. Like that, Layascha Vinashanancha. So subsiding only to rise later, and destruction where they won't rise again. Subsiding and getting destroyed are two kinds, ubhaya rodhane. There are two kinds of restraint. In one kind of restraint, the troublemaker, the ego, just becomes quiet. In another, it is finished off. And in spirituality, ultimately, we desire annihilation of the ego. The ego should be done to death. Sorry to use a violent language. Destruction, done to death, etc. seem to be a bit of himsatmaka bhasha. But we should not fight too shy also of this himsa. This is destruction of an utter troublemaker. Just as in a snake, the poisonous fang is the danger. If the poisonous fangs of a snake are taken out, the snake is harmless. You can also put that snake on your neck like Lord Shiva does. Lord Shiva puts even poisonous snakes upon his body. They cannot do anything to him. You and I can. If it's a rubber snake, we can put it on our head. Because they are harmless. So in the mind, you and I get millions of thoughts. Deepak Chopra used to say in the good old days, a man typically gets 60,000 thoughts per day. Some calculation they had made. And then he used to add, you know, typically a man gets 60,000 a day, and as many as 55,000 of them are what he had thought the previous day also. There is so much of repetition in our thinking. Because we all are, on one hand, intelligent human beings, but on the other, to an extent, mechanical. We are machines. We are programmed by life situations, our past experiences, by varieties of conditionings. To talk about freshness of approach is easy, but to really look at things with a fresh and open mind is very hard. So, let's go by Deepak Chopra. I used to call him Pop Vedantin. Pop is not pop music. Pop basically means popular. So he was a popular Vedantin. Even now he is well known. He is running a mind-body institute in San Diego, California. So if we have 60,000 thoughts, now very remarkably, among them, just to throw a ballpark figure, some 10,000 thoughts are such thoughts that constitute the ego. they are the poisonous fang of the snake called the mind. If egoistic thoughts are removed, then the other 50,000 thoughts are not harmful at all. If you say, you look at sunrise and say, how beautiful, and somewhere you see some disorder, why is it all so disorderly? You make a comment to perceive, to make a comment. If you remember factual things, yesterday was October 17, tomorrow is going to be October 19, if you say, and this is a thought, but there is no, nobody is hurt, nor are you hurting yourself. But a certain subset of that 60,000 thoughts is judgmental, it puts man against man on some bias, height, weight, color of skin, qualification, or what nationality, where one had done one's college studies, and so many factors. Somebody is talked of as high, somebody else is talked of as low, and so much human misery is created thereby. And as though it is not enough in the material world, we carry that to spiritual world also. Even as a man is meditating, he gets a thought, I introduced my wife to meditation, but she has gone ahead these days. Next time I say I will change, the lady sits and thinks, I took my husband to the classes and he is ahead of me now. So no gender bias here, please. But you see, in material world, wealth and possessions and qualification and height, weight, etc., okay. In spirituality also, I think he has a purer mind than I am. I think she is closer to our guru than I am. I think, so in this way, judgmentalism. So, as I said before, while explaining the word psychological domain, you come to a judgment on pieces of information which are utterly inadequate to come to such a judgment, right? That is called psychological domain. In a functional domain, if you are buying some white cloth, you really want bright white cloth, you go to a cloth shop and you see, this is a little dull and we want very bright white, this is white, very bright. There it is not psychological, it is functional, it is factual. And your policy was, as you, before you entered, you wanted, you know, bright white. Somewhere else you wanted something of good height. And like that, very advanced things also. There are lots of, in fact, great thinkers have gone into this a lot. How the human mind, more intelligent it is, more it is into measuring. It measures height, weight, length, mass, time. You know, in physics you have an LMT analysis, length, mass and time. Lots of things are expressed as having certain dimension, certain, you know, description in terms of length, certain description in terms of mass, certain description in terms of time. Anyway, without going more into physics, the human mind is unable to stop. It then wants to measure a person, wants to measure everybody. It wants to, human mind wants to pigeonhole everybody. She is good, he is bad, she is better, he is worse. Somehow this judgmentalism becomes a major problem there. Life gets again and again divided. In certain ashrams in India, you have on the basis of caste. You go to the ashram, you go to the temple, then there is prasad, lunch time. They will say, Brahmins go here and eat, non-Brahmins go there. Other day there was a discussion somewhere on this. Then surprisingly, somebody gave a counter example. Well, in certain airports, in fact many airports, US citizens move freely, and other citizens go through a lot of check. Is it not another casteism? Somebody asked. That was thought-provoking, you know. So, some Brahmin with a thread is allowed to go into some special hall. Others are sent to another hall. Here also, carrying the US passport on his head. Go on, sir. No checking. And so this US passport is like a sacred thread. Please think about it. And both of them have their own justification. You know, you may say that that is as per some agreement in some international discussions. So the Hindu society also says this was also an agreement in some big religious conference. Now some leftists and intellectuals are questioning it. Otherwise it has its own basis, blah, blah, blah. So both can be looked at as blah, blah, or both can be appreciated in some respects, you know, whatever it is, judgmentalism. So on caste, on cash, on color of skin, in numerous ways, and it extends to spiritual domain also, in terms of meditation, in terms of how much punyatma I am, how much a papi I am. So, a meritorious person and a sinful person. And there is a saying in English, those who kill by the sword also die by the sword. You know, these mafia people, they kill, they shoot, and one day they get shot. One day, you have what is called police fake encounters also. The police come and simply shoot him. And later on they say, you know, he tried to kill us and so on. If we go into it, it's all, you know, big, big mess it is, including the case 4 days ago in your own Fort Worth. At my night 2 a.m. a policeman comes and shoots an innocent, you know, young lady. So, why do we do that? It is this ragadvesha. It is this judgmentalism. It is various biases. And spirituality is concerned with eliminating biases, eliminating prejudices. Ramana Maharshi says, laya is when the prejudice is not uprooted, it just subsides. Vinashana is when the deep prejudices are uprooted. Because you neither judge yourself nor you judge others. It's in that context I quoted, those who kill by the sword also die by the sword. If you judge others on the basis of caste or cash or height or whatever, you cannot help but judge yourself too. Suppose you are envious of somebody who is tall, then when you look at yourself in the mirror and you are short, you will feel bad. You can't have another measuring tool. If you are envious of people with money and one of your daughters hasn't made much money, you cannot say, with respect to my daughter, I will accept her as she is. You can't. It's not easy. Because everywhere in the town you are measuring people by how much money they have. And when you look at your 4 children, you find one of the children hasn't made money. A certain inauspicious sound will come from your mouth. I don't know. Those who kill by the sword also die by the sword. You can't suddenly change the yardstick. Therefore, the best thing is neither with respect to others nor with respect to your own children or yourself for that matter, keep any bias. Be objective. Be open. Don't be carried away by flimsy, superficial issues. Go by something deeper. As you go deeper, everyone outside also is lovable, no matter what they are. And the best part is, you will find yourself lovable, no matter how you are doing. You would love yourself truly, even in sunny times, even in times of good health, etc. And another phase of life comes where you are bedridden. Then, because of your non-judgmental outlook, you will love yourself. While, of course, taking whatever medical care, etc., that's a different issue. But psychologically, even if the whole town pities you because you are bedridden, with physical pain, you will not have mental pain. You will look at yourself and you are at peace. This is also a phase. This also has come, this also will go. So there is a certain peace in non-judgmentalism. Vinashana is destruction of the ego. The second line of 13 makes it clear. Layagatam narbhavati. If through some japa, some meditation, some yoga, some pranayama, some mantra, some tantra, or some drugs. Today you have lots of drugs also. Take drugs, heavenly. And then you say, I know, this is what the rishis of India had experienced. I found a shortcut, okay? hold on. You know, maybe 9 out of 10 rishis through karma and upasana, through yoga and pranayama got it. In their case, the ego rises again. But 1 out of 10 or 1 out of 100 rishis, through the purest wisdom, not just made their agitation subside, but they removed the root cause. That is vinashana. Layagatam punarbhavati comes again. Whereas, no is a Sanskrit word here, na and one particle called u becomes no.